Hi friends, myself Dr. Ilyas, and welcome to Sully's Rounds. Today, I am going to discuss about the second part of the life-threatening ECG series. This is the ECG of 55-year-old man with chest pain. So what is your diagnosis? And this is another ECG, and this is the ECG of the same patient after 30 minutes. So look carefully and tell me, what is your diagnosis? Even though the first ECG looks like a normal pattern, careful examination might reveal important clue to diagnosis. So coming to the findings, so in this first ECG, we can see that the PR interval is prolonged. Here, you can see that it is 280 milliseconds. Normally, PR interval is 120 to 200 milliseconds. So here it is 280 milliseconds. That indicate first degree heart block. And the lead V1 shows RSR dash pattern. And the lead V6 shows slurred S5 and also in lead 1. Again, we can see that there is concordant ST elevation in lead V2. Also, we can see that there is QR pattern in lead 1 and AVL. And we can see that there is RS pattern in 2-3 AVF. And also, there is left axis deviation. That is, the QRS in lead 1 is predominantly upright and QRS in lead AVF is predominantly downwards. This indicates left axis deviation. And in the second ECG of the same patient, we can see that ST elevation in lead V2 and also in lead V3. And we can see that there is hyperacute T wave in lead V4. The findings are first degree heart block, right bundle branch block, that means RSR dash pattern in lead V1, slurred S5 in lead 1 AVL and V6, and QRS duration of more than 120 milliseconds. And LAHB means left axis deviation, QR pattern in lead 1 AVL and RS pattern in 2-3 AVF. And ischemia is suggested by concordant ST elevation in lead V2, V3 and hyperacute T wave in lead V4 and V5. So, how to diagnose ischemia in right bundle branch block? Because RBBB is frequently encountered in emergency department. It is often difficult to identify ischemic changes in right bundle branch block. So, before going to discuss about ischemia in right bundle branch block, we should know some basics regarding right bundle branch block. So normally, the ventricular septum depolarizes first, and it is followed by right ventricular depolarization, then left ventricular depolarization. Predominantly, the depolarization is towards left ventricle, so the right ventricular depolarization we cannot identify separately in ECG. So that means that normally the QRS complex in lead V1 is predominantly negative because the right sided lead like V1 sees the electrical activity as moving away from V1. Remember this important thing, the S wave means the depolarization is going away from something. And R wave means depolarization is going towards something. Here, the depolarization wave is going away from lead V1. And so there is less R wave and there is a predominant S wave in lead V1. So that means that normally the QRS complex show a predominantly negative wave. In this picture, we can see that the right bundle branch is blocked. And there is delayed RV depolarization. That lead to wide QRS complex, that is more than 110 milliseconds. So in right-sided precordial leads like V1 and V2, there is an initial R wave, that is small R wave, that indicate septal depolarization, that is a normal phenomenon. And it is followed by a large S wave, that indicate left ventricular depolarization. And it is followed by an R dash wave, that is a second positive wave. And this indicate delayed RV depolarization. Normally, we cannot get this R dash because the RV depolarization is merged with the LV depolarization. So, In this case, that is in case of right bundle branch block, we will get this positive R dash after the S wave because of the delayed right ventricular depolarization. And in left-sided precordial leads like V5 and V6, there is R S complex will get. That is, the R wave indicate LV depolarization and S wave indicate slow RV depolarization with slurred S wave. So here, look at this ECG, and here in V1, we can see that there is an RS R dash pattern. And in V6, we can get an RS pattern with a deep, broad and slurred S wave in V5, V6 and one AVL. So this is the characteristic ECG of right bundle branch block. That is, in lead V1, we will get RS R dash pattern, and one AVL V5, V6, we will get a broad, deep and slurred S wave. So in lead V1, we will get this RS R dash pattern. And we can see that this QRS complex is followed by an ST depression and T inversion. The red colored arrow indicate the direction of QRS complex, and blue color arrow indicate the direction of ST and T. So it is always discordant. That is, ST and T will be always in discordance with the QRS activity in case of right bundle branch block. Here, lead 1 and V6, you can see that there is an R wave, initial small Q with the R followed by S wave. Here, we can see the terminal QRS deflection is downwards, but ST and T changes is upwards. So the ST and T wave is always discordant compared to the QRS complex. So this is the diagram which shows the normal conduction pathway. The bundle of is actually divided into right bundle branch and left bundle branch. And this left bundle branch is again divided into left anterior fascicle and left posterior fascicle. In right bundle branch block, the axis of QRS will be always normal, unless there is coexistent left anterior hemi block or left posterior hemi block. So in case of left anterior hemi block, there is left axis deviation, and you can see that there is predominant positive wave in one AVL, that is a QR pattern in one and AVL. And in inferior leads, we can see that there is negative QRS complex, that is S wave is more than R wave. And along with this, the QRS duration of less than 110 millisecond and left axis deviation, and this is called left anterior hemi block. And if there is right axis deviation, always suspect left posterior hemi block in RBBB. So in left posterior hemi block, it is actually the reversal of left anterior hemi block. That is, there is predominant negative wave in 1-9 AVL, that is S wave is more than R wave, and positive QRS complex in inferior leads, that is tall R wave. This indicate left posterior hemi block in right bundle branch block. And coming to the criteria of right bundle branch block, the four criteria should be satisfied to say it is a case of right bundle branch block. The first one is the QRS duration should be more than 120 millisecond. And second criteria is the RS R dash pattern in lead V1 or V2. And third criteria is the S wave of greater duration than R wave, or S wave duration more than 40 millisecond in lead 1 and V6. That is deep, broad, slurred S wave in 1 and V6. And fourth criteria is R wave peak time should be more than 50 millisecond in V1 and normal in V6. So what is mean by this R wave peak time? So in this diagram, we can show that the R wave in lead V1, the R wave is peaked after 100 millisecond from the start of QRS. And in V6, it is actually 40 millisecond. So it is normal. So the R wave peak time of more than 50 millisecond in lead V1 with the normal R wave peak time in V6 is a criteria for right bundle branch block. Right bundle branch is supplied by left anterior descending artery, that is LAD. And normal repolarization abnormality in right bundle branch block can mimic or mask ischemic changes. So it is very important to identify ischemia related to right bundle branch block. And this is because the mortality in STEMI are higher in new right bundle branch block compared to new left bundle branch block. And the RBBB is an high-risk feature, especially if it is new and it is accompanied by left anterior ME block. And this is associated with the increased mortality and poor outcome in acute coronary syndrome. And according to European Society of Cardiology, they actually advise primary PCI in patients with the persistent ischemic symptoms in the presence of right bundle branch block. It is very important to identify RBBB equivalent pattern because there is not always RSR dash pattern in V1. Sometimes it may be other patterns that is actually equivalent to this right bundle branch block. We know that the QRS complex in lead V1 is predominantly negative. It is because the right-sided lead sees electrical activity as moving away from V1. And finding of a predominant positive activity, that means tall R wave in V1 is not normal. Finding of predominant positive activity, that is tall R in V1, is not normal. Coming to various right bundle branch morphologies in lead V1, we can see that the RSR dash pattern and RSR dash pattern, that is the difference is in the first one, that is upper one, we can see that a small R is followed by a large S wave followed by a large second positive R wave. And in lower one, we can see that the initial R and S are very small. And next, we can see an RR dash pattern. And there is RSR dash pattern. And this is RSR dash. The difference is that the size of the V wave. And QR pattern, that is initial a large negative wave, that is Q wave followed by an R wave. And another QR, that is small Q followed by a large R. So these all thing can get in right bundle branch block. So these are the RBBB equivalents. So always remember these patterns. And in RBBB, the QRS is usually more than 120 millisecond. And in an ECG, there is features of RBBB is present, but the QRS is less than 120 millisecond. This is called incomplete right bundle branch block. And it is present in 5% of the normal population. So it is usually seen in patients with bronchial asthma, COPD, pulmonary embolism, RVH, like that. In 5% patients, we can get this finding as a normal thing. Coming to the topic, that is how to identify ischemia in right bundle branch block. The first thing is the concept of appropriate discordance. So we already discussed that in right bundle branch block, the terminal QRS deflection and STT are in discordance. And if there is any concordant ST elevation, this indicates ischemia. That here we can see that in the CCG, there is ST elevation in lead V1 and V2. That is actually a concordant finding. We will not get this finding in normal RBBB. And second thing is the excessive discordant ST depression. That is more than 2 millimeter. So in the CCG, we can see that there is excessive ST depression in V2 and V3. This much ST depression we will not get in normal right bundle branch block. So this again indicates ischemia. And the QR pattern, the importance of QR pattern in lead V1 and V2 with ST elevation. So the presence of QR pattern in V1 or V2 with the minimal ST elevation is indicate the left anterior descending artery occlusion proximal to first septal branch. So we can see that this is the normal coronary circulation. Here, the LAD is occluded proximal to first septal branch. Another thing is pseudo-normalization of negative T wave in V1, V3 that may mask minimal ST elevation. We already discussed that the T wave will be inverted in V1 to V3 in right bundle branch block. So in presence of ischemia, this T wave is become upright, that is pseudo-normalized. And this can mask a very minimal ST elevation in V1 to V3. So that actually misleading. Here also we can see that this upright T wave in V1, this V2 and V3. And next finding is the T wave inversion in limb leads with R wave larger than S wave. So here in this ECG, we can see that in lead 3, there is T inversion. But the terminal QRS deflection is also upright. And also the S wave is actually more than R wave. So in that case, we can get T inversion normally. But in the absence of this feature, if there is T wave inversion in limb leads, that is two anatomically contiguous limb leads, it indicates again ischemia. So take home points are the mortality in STEMI are higher in new RBBB compared to new LBBB. It is an high-risk feature, especially if it is new and it is accompanied by left anterior ME block, and it results in increased mortality and poor outcome. Primary PCA is indicated in persistent ischemic symptoms in the presence of right bundle branch block. And always remember the concept of appropriate discordance. Remember, QR pattern in V1 indicate ischemia because the right bundle branch block will not alter the initial direction of septal depolarization. So in RBBB, always there will be a positive R wave, initial R wave, unless there is ischemia. So coming to next ECG, this is an ECG of a 65-year-old woman with atypical chest pain. So what are the findings in this ECG? Initially, it may look like a normal ECG, but it is not. So we can see that there is ST elevation in lead V2 and AVF, and also minimal ST depression in lead 3 and lead AVF. So this actually indicates the first diagonal branch occlusion. So the diagonal branch is the branch of left anterior descending artery. So in this occlusion, we will get ST elevation in AVL and V2 and ST depression in lead 3 and AVF. So it is important because in STEMI definition, the ST elevation should be in two anatomically contiguous leads. But here, the lead AVL and lead V2 are not anatomically contiguous. So it is important to identify this pattern. And ST elevation in V2 and AVL with the lack of ST elevation in other precordial leads indicate D1 occlusion with a positive predictive value of 90%. And here we can see that this is the first diagonal branch which is blocked in this ECG. If this D1 is get blocked, what happened is the ST vector is going towards this lead V2, lead AVL and lead 1. And also towards this negative lead 3 and negative lead AVF. So there will be ST elevation in V2, AVL, and sometimes in lead 1, and ST depression is present in lead 3 and lead AVF. So the important finding is that definitely there is ST elevation in lead V2 and AVL, and ST depression in lead 3. So if we get this pattern, it indicates the D1 occlusion. So this is the ECG which is showing ST elevation in lead V2, lead AVL and lead 1, and also ST depression with the T inversion in lead 3 and lead AVF. So this indicate D1 occlusion. High lateral STEMIs are frequently missed even by an experienced physician because of the apparently non-contiguous nature of ST elevation. That is, there is ST elevation in lead 1, AVL and V2. Sometimes it may be only in AVL and V2 and ST depression in 3 and AVF. So always remember the South African flag pattern. That means there is ST elevation in 1 AVL and V2 and ST depression in lead 3. This pattern follow the South African flag in 12 lead ECG. So here in this ECG, we can see that there is ST elevation in AVL, V2 and 1 and ST depression in lead 3 and AVF. Sometimes only minimal ST elevation in AVL and V2 with ST depression in 3 is seen in D1 occlusion. And it is frequently missed because the ST depression in 3 and AVF is mistaken for inferior wall ischemia, and we will miss this ST elevation, MI. That is, here we can see that there is ST elevation in lead V2 and AVL and ST depression in lead 3 and AVF. So it may be mistaken for this inferior wall ischemia. So always remember this pattern is seen in D1 occlusion. So in summary, you should have a clear-cut idea about right bundle branch block and ischemic changes related to right bundle branch block. Always remember the concept of appropriate discordance in right bundle branch block. Presence of QRBB indicate ischemia. Also, if you see ST depression in lead 3, always look for minimal ST elevation in AVL and lead V2 for diagnosing D1 occlusion. So, thanks for watching. If you like this video, please share and subscribe.